So okay. Okay. Sorry about that. So you're streaming this? Or is this being streamed? Or? Okay. Sorry about that. And sorry about the feedback. For our next trick, well, these are our blacklists where you put them in your spamd.conf for very straightforward format here. On FreeBSD and FreeBSD is a package you need to install and you actually need to, well, read a package message and do what it says. It needs a file descriptor, file system for some reason. And of course, you can tweak things like the spamd flags. The G flag is the first number is number of minimum number of minutes for retry. The next one is number of hours a gray listed entry lives, and the last one is number of hours a white listed entry lives. And this number is little more than 1 month, so your monthly password reminders will pass. you can do a few more evil tricks. Now we already mentioned the connections from our real mail servers. And I know that if you're Henning broke NAT in 4.7.4.8, so but that's fixed. So, one of my clients had a problem with one of these, but we fixed that afterwards. So, now this is basically what it looks like when a spammer is connecting. That address has never been valid, and it's here we managed to waste 404 seconds, which is quite a few minutes. This is a very old one. Riffing on. Here's another one that lasted for 32 minutes, but after a while, we had somebody actually hang on for 12 hours. So it's these are quite rare. We tried graphing, you know, how long people hang on, and I just needed to set a roof at about 1,000 seconds because they were, you can reasonably graph something that like 42,000 seconds, but essentially all the data is anyway in the 300 to 300 interval. But so it's a lot of fun to watch those attempts happening. Now, I mentioned invalid addresses. I think it was Bob who came up with the gray trapping. Gray trapping is like an extension of the gray listing technique. And what you do is, like I mentioned earlier, if you have like fish out of your reject logs, somebody has tried to send spam with the non-valid address in your domain. You fish that out of your reject log, and you put that into your SpamDB database as a gray trap. So anybody who tries to deliver mail to that address gets added to your local blacklist and gets stared at for the next 24 hours. I've been evil enough to start, over the years, I have something like 28,000 odd addresses like that fished out of my logs, and I export that the resulting blacklist every hour. It's been anything from a couple of hundred to roughly 40,000, but it varies a lot. slightly larger list that gets generated in this way is the UA traps list generated by, well, Bob used to work at the University of Alberta. The UA traps trap list is still generated there. Typically, some tens of thousands of addresses that try to deliver junk to non-existent U of A addresses. You can supplement your trapping with that, and you're of course welcome to use mine, which is also in the slides. Well, several things have happened with SpamD over the years. One is you can sync gray lists and white lists between several instances. There's also work going on with BGP SpamD, a slight abuse of BGP to exchange whitelists and blacklists via BGP. I think Peter Hessler is coming here later. Anyway, he had a nice presentation on that last year, I think. So it's possible to participate in that network. Now, your boss's boyfriend will probably not want to be bogged down by SpamD, and there are other people who do not correspond with you very often, or that, for that matter, the Google problem, as we used to call it. Yes, they retry, but they have a large farm of outgoing MXs, and they do not retry from the same address. That can lead to problems if you're small enough. If you're big enough, you probably have these mail servers in your whitelist, in your automatically generated whitelist anyway. For the rest of us, SpamD, basically do not expose those addresses to SpamD. SpamD is a lot of fun, easy to set up, costs you basically nothing, will save you electricity, and I've blogged a bit about it at various times, so look up my blog if you're interested. But there's also a graph somewhere in here with the typical how long they hang on and so forth. Next up, what's your suggestion? We have lunch at 1, isn't it? 1 or 1:15? So we have 1.5, 2 hours to spend. One thing you could do it really depends on what your requirements are. You could do things like you could do something like say you have logical groups of rules and say apply to this interface or that interface. You could chuck them into separate anchors, or just include. Use the include file technique. That's one possibility. Then again, it's always there is no silver bullet really, but you need to go back to specifications or your requirements, see where you can optimize. But there are tricks like I did have a. At one point, a.
There's no like table for ports, right?
No. But you would have something like common criteria for. you might want to be looking at anchors.
But will that actually lower the amount of?
Well, it's not necessarily. Well, you could do something like this, where you say you have a set of rules that only apply to a certain interface, like this one. You lump them together under common criteria, like this. It's one way of grouping them anyway. But then again, if you you're starting from a 2000 rule set, you probably have quite complex criteria to start with. Then again, look for logical groupings, things like that. If you want to, then again, we would really need to look into your specific configuration to see whether it's something we can optimize. Because, well, it's hard to say something in general. Well, the optimizer would be, well, anything else. Well, are you an OpenBSD or FreeBSD?
OpenBSD.
Yeah. 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 So.
Well, seriously, I mean, the OpenBSD is like four times as fast as the OpenBSD, so that's way more performance. And the rules that optimizer will take care of, rather than just grouping together automatically.
Yeah, you no, there is no table equivalent for ports. Port ranges are not expanded. They're actually encoded in the rules. You could use port ranges if your other criteria are equal. You use port ranges that's possible. Then again, that would be port range from to larger than, smaller than, not equal to. You might compress your rules with some like port ranges, but then again, I would need to look at your rule sets to see what the possibility. Then again, it's always useful to load verbosely to see what actually gets loaded. And once you start debugging, you probably want to I forget whether I put that in the in the slides here. It's definitely in the book, but for debugging purposes, you can have log a match rule that match log matches. So criteria, whatever, match say your test host, log matches. What that does is that it will log whatever rules are matched in your rule set by the traffic that matches your log matches rule, which becomes fairly interesting in cases where 2,000 rules and you don't know which one is matching. Well, log matches is your is your friend. But then again, your 2,000 rules probably came from hopefully came from a specification. Yeah. So. Port ranges is one thing, and as Henning said, please optimize for readability. Performance is really taken care of anyway. So now, what's next? Where we use the next. We got about 1.5 hours, and I think still too many slides. So what do you want to hear about?
What is the best practice to see a left bucket converse for each rule? Let's say you have a PF.conf, and you want to see the number of buckets matching each rule. Is there some way to do that?
Well, there are several ways. One would be PF control VVSR, which would
VVSR,
yeah, which would which will dump your rule set with all these counters in place. Hang on. This would be an extremely simple rule set on his laptop. Yeah, it will look something like this, where you have the number of packets. This is basically the default rule set, where you have number of evaluations, packets passed, bytes passed, and the number of active states, which is surprisingly high for practically a passive laptop, and then again, in your slightly longer rule set, each rule will expand like this. If you go to just one V, you will get something. This is the just a raw, basically the loaded rule set. There used to be a difference between V and VV. Yeah. So anyway, LVSR will give you what you want. The other way to, if you want, there are specific rules you want to keep track of. There's this trick. Labels. Specific traffic you want to keep track of, but not others. Well, anything that matches. Say in this example here, to and from whatever the email server is, and. You would again the PFVS VSR would give you the output, but you can also do something like PF control minus VSL, which dumps the data for the label, and this is if you want to script it and feed it to your database or whatever, this is what you want to do. I guess that's roughly according to the question. There used to be PF top. There are also on OpenBSD there's sysstat rules. We have sysstat knows a number of things. This is the sysstat view of the state table on this laptop. Yeah. So let's see if we can fit it in here. Yeah, it fits. So. This is a live view, or updated every second or so, of the state table. this is what PF top does in other operating systems. Systat has a number of other views that are interesting as well. This is the Systat on OpenBSD is a lot more powerful than on other BSDs. Now again, for if you want to track all your traffic, you probably want something like pflow. Again, you want OpenBSD 4.5 or newer. I forgot to check whether pflow actually made it into FreeBSD. I don't think so.
It's in the main page, but it's not.
Yeah. So yeah, but anyway, it's well. Then again, on.
So for what's the documentation about?
Yeah.
Yeah. So, but anyway, pflow. One of the good things that came out of Cisco was the NetFlow specification. Basically, what you record about your traffic is, well, any connection is consists of two flows, one in each direction. Each one has a source and destination address, start and end time, number of bytes, number of packets, protocol. You record that, and for each, so you have all the interesting data about a connection, metadata in, what is it, 100 and well, maybe 200 bytes. So basically, if all you want to know is the metadata, this is a very, very cheap way of recording it. And there are a number of, you set up a sensor like this, where you can, again, if there are only specific rules that that interest you, you set up the exports or records data in the pflow format. Or if you want to set it as a state default, you can do that. Again, this is probably not in FreeBSD yet. And well, before you actually get to record anything, you need to create the configure the pflow interface, and what it needs is a flow source and where to send the data, which is where your collector is. There are a number of collectors. My favorite, and I believe several other people's, is NFSEN, based on NFDump. Is basically package add NFSEN, read me, and within minutes, you have nice graphs of your pflow data, and you can drill down. So that's another very, very nice interface for learning what your network actually does. I think that's if you want to look into NetFlow in general. Michael Lucas has a very nice book called Network Flow Analysis out. I think he was not aware of NFSEN when he wrote it, because he wrote the book about the flow tools, which is, well, but it's a very useful book. Michael writes great books, so please buy all of them. For FreeBSD and for other, there are several NetFlow collectors. PFFlowD, written by Damien Miller, is a fairly useful one, which will it will do what you want if you don't have a PFLOW. Yes. What's the other? What's the next thing we riff off? Do we go back to the menu? No, that's not going to work. I was thinking. Anyone for traffic shaping? Oh, we have. Well, there are well, where to start? Well, in general, CARP doesn't do much damage to a rule set, but there are things to be aware of. To the extent that traffic originates at the CARP hosts, it will have the source address of that host, probably not the CARP interface. That's a thing to keep in mind. Then again, whenever the CARP interface bounces between the hosts, that would typically be that the CARP interface address is something like your default gateway for other hosts. Then again, keep in mind that the rule set probably needs to pass or at least treat traffic that has the physical host's address appropriately. Stuff like the CARP announcements will go out with the real real address, not the virtual one. But for your general purpose traffic, well, CARP is intended to be as invisible as possible. So you need to compensate for the fact that you will probably have more addresses involved in source and destination traffic involving your CARP hosts. So you may need to work that into a rule set, so something like the first rule here for your actual CARP traffic to pass, and you may want to include even say a table or a list of addresses that should be able to pass CARP traffic. Other than that. Take care of the CARP and PFSync to actually pass. Other than that, it should be almost invisible. You probably have more stories better than mine. But yeah. So. Then again, you have stuff like there are, of course, as you're probably aware, there is traffic that is not really useful to sync across, like in this example, SSH into the specific host. Well, the context gets lost when it's failed over anyway, so there is stuff you can just throw away. Well, again, for best practice purposes, your group of CARP hosts will hopefully be identical hardware-wise. Otherwise, you might actually do workarounds with the interface groups to filter on the interface groups and get away with physically non-identical CARP hosts. Yeah, that's a valid trick. If you really can't get identical boxes, interface groups are your friend. That's probably the
bit.
Yes, they're our friend anyway. So filtering on interface groups.
These days, I usually have my tools that always refer to interface groups.
Yeah.
And I just put single interfaces in interface groups. Of course, that nicely makes rules in the interlay machine.
Yes.
So you put the same rules in a different machine and just assign the interface to the right interface groups and be done. But reading your rules, that's something instead of EF0, I'm calling it outbound or something like that. Also makes things clear.
Interface groups,
how do you look at you? You set them up with, in, you know, you, if can't take them in. Yes, something like this. If config, yeah. And I believe it originated in OpenBSD. I believe it made it into FreeBSD eventually.
Yeah.
Extremely useful. As Henning says here, it's possible to have a group with only one member. If you take a look at your ifconfig output, at least in OpenBSD, you will have something like, yes, my wireless interface is in the group WLAN. This one has my default route, so it's in the egress group. There are a few default groups, like, well, the PFLog interfaces has the PFLog group, but you can define your own, and you can have an arbitrary number of interfaces in them, as long as they have something in common, it makes sense. So, which is a number of man page examples, as well as, I believe, some in my presentation here in the book, is you typically filter on egress, which is, well, makes sense. Your default route interface, which is probably, if you're a firewall, that's probably the interesting, at least one of the interesting places to filter. That's probably the best tip you will get. And now for practical traffic shaping thing, if you're interested. An experiment that lasted 15 years was Alt-Q. And it came out of a research paper it's late 90s research paper. Yeah. And it was finally, it was a good paper. And basically, they were exploring how to shape traffic, and they came up with a number of algorithms. Not all of them were ever implemented, but somewhere in the old world of Alt-Q, we had basically three of them. Henning here started replacing that because the experiment was over at one point.
It was research.
Yeah,
and
so.
There was no broad knowledge of the different traffic algorithms. So, research, that's what it was all about.
So, but anyway, the teaser was in OpenBSD 5.0, where I guess I'm getting ahead of myself a little, but the basic always-on priorities, which is exclusive to OpenBSD, where you get priorities 0 through 7. In general, default to a sensible value of 3, but you can tweak them. And what you could with a rule that matches specific traffic, you can set two different priorities, basically to to get your acts transferred, so your actual data doesn't need to wait quite as long for the first in, first out. On low bandwidth or high latency links, this helps you a lot because default queuing. Well, if there is no queuing enabled, everything has to wait in line, first in, first out. Thing is, the way TCP works is, well, you keep sending, but you will expect an ACK back that, well, yeah, we actually received this stuff. Otherwise, it will resend, and that will clog up your modem, your dial-up line fairly quickly. So there was this trick that was described in a nice little article by Daniel Hotmaya, who used to be a main PF developer, where he used alt queue for just to set up a system of two priority queues, one with the high priority, one with the default priority. And basically, the acts which are low delay priority will skip ahead. You can tweak those a little. Basically, just adding something like this, match out on egress, set with two priorities, you will. On a low bandwidth link, you probably will see a difference. Now, for
the two
values is for, well, your bulk traffic and your higher priority traffic, the TOS low delay will be sent on the higher priority queue. Now, this is the syntax for the new queue, queue name on some interface bandwidth number. Which is, well, actually I should say number and optionally K kilobits, megabits, or gigabit, because a raw number is bits, just bits. So that's your main queue, your queues that are actually allocated traffic will be sub queues that name their parent, and of course they receive a defined amount of bandwidth, and one of them needs to be the default. Moving on to a relatively simple, yes, okay. Now, of course, what's your usable bandwidth? Well, ask your ISP. There is always an overhead, in your raw Ethernet, that's probably somewhere in the single-digit percentage. Some ADSL implementations can steal something like 20%, but you will. If you get unpredictable results, you probably set your interface bandwidth too high, and in a typical setup, you will have your egress interface will probably be something like gigabit, but it's quite likely that it's not actually on a gigabit bandwidth, but it will still report it has a gigabit. So this is where you set your bandwidth to what you believe it is correct. If you set it too high, you will get strange results, but you might need to tune it. And anyway, what a lot of people forget is that for whatever your queue is, it can only usefully shape relative to, well, the lowest bandwidth in your signal path. So basically, if you flood too much, well, packets will get dropped anyways. So, and that's the basic truth of traffic shaping is that sooner or later you will start dropping packets. So then again, moving on to a fixed bandwidth example, you have egress here. You probably only have one default route interface. Bandwidth of 20 megabit. Actually, this is something I used on my home gateway at some point. So you have default queue with the defined bandwidth. FTP was once a favored protocol. UDP, various. And something for web, something for SSH. And for SSH, we do the variation of the priorities trick here with one queue for called interactive and one queue called bulk. Now the we assign here using pass rules. But then again, if you're not already shaping and you're running OpenBSD, you probably just tag a few OpenMatch rules for queue assignment on top of your rule set. Because, well, you probably have filtering in place, and editing all your filtering rules gets old fast. So if you already have a rule set in place and you want to do shaping, do it by match rules. It's something like this. On the a slightly more involved example, yes, this is probably the more interesting thing. This is where what HFSC looks like in real life. You have your root queue here, and one that is the parent of several others, which has a fairly flexible allocation here, but it gets sub-allocated to the queues that have a guaranteed minimum, a maximum, and perhaps the more interesting thing here is for this queue, we have a relatively low bandwidth, but it can have burst activity for 3,000 milliseconds. Here, it will be can be allocated this much, and well, of course, we always get back to spamd where we get one. Just to maybe a little more evil to our spammers, only one k allocated. Minimum zero, and a queue limit. Well, basically, you can backlog up to 300 packets here, which is the max, I think. Problem with these small allocations is that you might actually end up giving them more because you're getting into conflict with the resolution for the timer that actually measures this. So then again. Assign whatever traffic you have with the mesh rules, and assign with a set queue, and you'll be good. You should be able to watch your queues live with systat queues. Now I'm wondering whether I can get into my yes. Yeah, this is what it looks like. You can see that. As you can see, this is, that's the exact configuration from the slides on my home gateway here, where we have, we're not nice to spammers. And the, you can see the other ones. Looks like my daughter has been surfing the web a lot lately. So it's either her or the cats. So, again, this is a live cystite. Well, you can get something like it's the PF control version. It refreshes every couple of seconds. And we really would want a little more display just to have it displayed properly. Now, converting from old Q to, converting to old Q from the old school. In OpenBSD 5.5, you still have the option of running your old Q. Old QQ rule set. But that's probably because you're German. Old Q became old Q. Anyway, for if you have an existing old Q setup, that's something like this. You will be able to, with a very quick search replace, make this work on OpenBSD 5.5 as well. This will just not load on OpenBSD 5.5. This will, but you only have the one release to make the adjustment to the new one, because somebody in this room was too lazy to maintain two code bases. But anyway, so it's, the old queue is gone in 5.6, and as I said on the slide, it's limited time only. OpenBSD 5.5 will stay supported for another 6 months. 5.5 will stay supported until 5.7 is out. So, yes, you have another 6 months, roughly. Well, there is seven, more or less. But after that, well, you're on your own with old Q on OpenBSD. And basically, you will want to convert. The new syntax is more readable. You can go by the old Q trick. I did that experimentally, but on a few cases. But anyway, the new Q is so much more readable. You will want to convert. Unfortunately, FreeBSD people do not have that option yet. I'm not sure whose arms we will need to twist, but. Now, for our next tricks, yes.
A question. Is there a possibility to simulate different lines, for example, different time delay dropping packets? Because we use such kinds now with maybe FW.
Because
write software and want to connect through modem line, for example, and I make the time delay drop packets randomly.
Well, dropping packets you could do pass or drop with probability.
Yes, I see.
So that's fairly easy. And of course, well, squeezing bandwidth, well, you have traffic shaping in place. Latency, we don't have a trick for latency. And it would, Well, it would take some effort to create, but. So, but I think Dominet has that on FreeBC, right? Dominet has that on FreeBC, isn't it? Or latency simulation.
Yes.
Yeah. So.
It's so additional framework.
The thing for dropping packets, well, you have the well, what I showed is the evil trick of passing or dropping the probability. So, but the latency we haven't really played with. There would be, might be evil ways to, no. Yes. Yes. Divert to some user land daemon that does its evil tricks and diverts back. That might work. But then you wouldn't need to supply the daemon.
So.
Yeah. So yeah. So basically, use the divert interface, do whatever evil tricks you want, and that will work. Then again, it's a bit of work to actually write that daemon, but, but it might be an interesting project.
So we use the daemon to simulate bad things to use AD.
Yeah. Well, for example. NSAD, yes. We've gotten through an amazing amount of material already. Now, we might want to. That's a actually a non-interactive shell. We can take a look at that. What you do is you create users with the authpf, with authpf as their shell. And what happens? Well, the way you use it is user SSH is in, and whatever is defined for that user or that group of users gets loaded for gets loaded. So basically, you supply the rules for that configuration. So yeah, your basics you would need to well, you need a table that has to have the name authpf underscore users. You also need to have the anchor where authpf inserts the rules. And, well, from there, well, the sky's the limit, really. Something like, well, if you want something to apply to everybody, you put it in the general authpf.rules file. Something like this, well, anything for any, which would mean anybody who had it authenticated, well, any IP address belonging to a user who authenticated would have traffic pass to your UDP services or and your and whatever these macros stand for. So this is your basic example. You could use something, well, for if you want to differentiate for different users, you would have something like this where you reference the user IP variable instead. A variation on your basic. No, the authpf inserts in the authpf anchor, but the you would need to write the the rules for whatever uses you.
Seeing where the user IP expands, it gets the information.
Well, the it would be the IP address. Well, the IP address that the user authenticated from. So if that's a NAT address for a large network, well, you may have a separate problem. But yeah, you authenticated from there. So let's see what we have here. Yeah, well, you have something like a user named Peter, who should be severely limited here. Basically, this is actually taken from a home network as well, which is this user is allowed to contact the web interface of our music server. and not much else. And the other one, well, anyone who comes from an OpenBSD OpenBSD machine is basically allowed to do anything, you know. You should be nice to OpenBSD users. Well, I haven't actually tried to fool the OS OS identification. It's supposed to be fairly solid, but. Would take a relatively smart attacker to exploit that. There is a favorite example of one who another use of the here's an example for somebody, actually Randall Swartz, Merlin. In the early days of PF and Alt-Q, he used this one for, well, during one of the virus storms, well, lots of crap came from Windows machines. He would set up his Alt-Q with something or other and a minimal queue for, let's say, mail from Windows machines. And anything that came from Windows machines to port 25 would be assigned to that queue. And I can't believe I didn't see this earlier. I wanted a huge difference in my load. So it's usable for that. Well, I think this possibly predates SpamD in a useful configuration. No, actually not. Yeah. But anyway, he may not have been aware of SpamD. Realistic, but you can, it's fairly reliable as long as you don't get too, nobody gets too smart at the other end, the OS detection. And you can use it in ways such as these. We had an example of, well, here we have a first part of an example for actually a friend of mine set up his set up his home gateway. Well, it's a totally open network, but anyone who had not basically anyone who is not authenticated and tries to access the web will be redirected to a web server that says, well, you tried to use my network, but I don't know you. Contact me. So, and in principle, these 10 lines or so of configuration at that web server, you could conceivably put something that accepts credit cards. So it's basically your start of a captive portal here. So, and you're that's only other other useful things. Briefly touched on troubleshooting your network. I've seen several networks recently where I was not able to ping back home to check for latency. Probably comes from I think it was 1994, 1995, ping of death, a malformed ping packet, a little too big payload would essentially kill the TCP stacks of several well-known operating systems. Those bugs were fixed, but your early advisory said, do not pass ICMP. Problem is that ICMP...
I want to see the same people turning on TCP because they have the bugs.
Yeah. Then again, some of these rules are, if you want ping to work and a number of other things to work, you probably want to pass at least some ICMP. Now, I've been in situations where I could not put that rule in there because, this reveals too much about your, could potentially reveal too much about your the structure of your internal network. So, you do something like, limit, put some kinds of limit on it. For example, you will define a number of ICMP packet types to be allowed to leave your network from the local network, and you will allow here certain ICMP types to your egress interface. That's something I implemented somewhere, and they were happy that, it will sort of work. And again, for ping to work, echo rec is the one you need. And again, your pass rule will stay the same even if you expand the macro. Traceroute, venerable traceroute actually uses UDP. On at least some Unixes, several other modern operating systems, including I think recent Linuxes, use ICMP Echo, and Microsoft definitely does. In OpenBSD, you can specify a few things to traceroute. Then again, one of the reasons why you do not want to block ICMP is path MTU discovery. Send off your packets, whatever size within your local links max transmission unit. If that, for some reason, is too big somewhere along the way, you will get the answer ICMP reply, which destination reachable. Fragmentation needed, do not fragment flag set. Okay, so for that connection, you will adjust the MTU. This will not happen at all, of course, if you block ICMP like the people who are scared by the ping of death.
That's not will actually match the TCP state. That will actually match the TCP state.
Yeah. So if you have keep states, most of it will piggyback. Well, you could do something like this to make sure everything actually passes red. But then again, most of your traffic will piggyback on your keep state anyway. Now ICMP, ICMP 6 for IP version 6, they no longer have ARP, so a lot of stuff passes over ICMP 6 that is important for stuff like IP version 6 auto configuration, finding out where your router is, stuff. Well, so if you run a reasonable sized IP version 6 network, you probably want to at least be aware that you may need to pass certain types of ICMP 6 through your gateways. You may or may not. Well, please look into it. It really depends on your local configuration and whatever you want to do with it. But some of these have turned up in the wild as quite useful. But again, you can buy Henning a beer, and he will tell you why IP version 6 is broken anyway. So, so how are we for time? Okay, another half hour to go. What do you do? Yeah, well, we can do that. Now, actually, Wi-Fi is. Our Wi-Fi support isn't that hot anymore. We don't have AC. We don't have N. It's a little. But anyway, historically, there was this. One problem with wireless, of course, is that, well, anybody can snoop you. In principle, it goes out over the airwaves, and, well, so. Make it a little more, try some privacy. They tried for, well, WEP, what they call wired equivalent privacy. And that always reminds me of your plastic pal that's fun to be with.
I actually think it's totally appropriate because that's what it provides.
Seriously,
if you have highly secret traffic and you're sending it unencrypted over wire, you're stupid.
Yes, because anyone who
so
can. Well, that assumes that you. If your wires are exposed enough that people can tap them, yes. So.
Rely on wire being inaccessible or somebody getting into some device on your network.
Yeah. So basically, you probably need some.
If you're being responsible in your wire networks, you don't have to treat your wires any different.
That's true. Use properly encrypted protocols, and that will probably do a lot more for your security. But anyway, the. Well, the point is that WEP was broken fairly quickly because it was, they didn't actually have any cryptographers in their design committee. They found somebody who actually knew crypto for WPA, but WPA was so over-engineered that it actually took several years for it to arrive in several free operating systems. This site, which is run by a University of Bergen professor, has a few good presentations about wireless security. I tend to just refer to that. But anyway, setting up on OpenBSD at least, it's simple as, well, something like this. You check that your card is actually recognized, and then you set it up like any other interface. Well, here we have a, I forget why it was 11B, probably just to demonstrate that we can actually be this specific. In the last few years, I've only really specified the media opt host app, which makes this an access point. Skip the mode because it's not interesting. You may want to specify a channel. And this is a web. You need a network ID. An NW key means it's a web setup. And again, you configure it like any other interface. Now you got an access point. On FreeBSD, it's a little more involved. Because, well, at some point, I forget which version, but there was a push to virtualize the network stack in FreeBSD, and it led to several interesting consequences. So this is what I had to do to set up a FreeBSD access point at one point. You make sure the driver for your wireless card is actually loaded, and you have the several other modules that also need to be loaded by your loader.conf. So you just won't get anywhere without that. And then, in addition to whatever you put in your I found the easiest way to configure a FreeBSD access point was to skip the rc.conf. You would normally be able to put this in your rc.conf only for whatever crazy reason I couldn't get it to work until I isolated it into a start_if.interface name. I still haven't got a good explanation of why, but that's what worked for me. So that's what I put in the presentation here. Again, you can you have the create args, physical interface. Well, you create the virtual interface. You set up the physical interface. And the two come together to create an interface that you can actually configure with something. Again, we probably didn't need to specify the mode here, but you can. After that, it gets, if you want WPA, there is no way on FreeBSD to avoid host app D, which is kind of bizarre, but this is what it looks like. The physical interface created roughly the same, but you need the stanza in your rc.conf to enable hostfd because it won't start otherwise. And you need to put a lot of goo in your hostfd.conf. This is the minimal configuration I managed to get working. HostFD will be able, with a bit of prodding, to actually play with most of the WPA's options. But I must admit, after getting this to work, I was so sick of it. I just thought, put this in the book and in the slides, and all, this will work. Now, if you want to do something otherwise, first start HostFD, and it will load. And you can play with a number of other. I think actually the sample hostfd.conf is not bad documentation. It's just really, really confusing. So basically, that's your how to get started on FreeBSD. And then again, WPA. Oh. This is WPA on OpenBSD, right? One line. This is, well, this is, if you want the, well, the more, the more advanced options, you will need to install a package called WPA supplicants, which is, well, I grew a little sick of it, so. So I, so it, yes, it is possible. Now, again, it's fairly straightforward as long as you're an OpenBSD. And of course, what happens to your rule set? Well, in most cases, well, in some cases, your your access point will simply be, well, it will be talking to that, to your network of wireless clients and your and whatever your upstream is. In that case, well, hang on, it's you configured like you would any other gateway for a small network. In some cases, you have made a very bad decision and added in a wireless interface to something that's already the gateway for a wired network. And in that case, well, you will need to do something like well, rules that also apply to the wireless interface, treat it like any other interface. And again, whatever policy you have, useful probably to do something like, well, define a macro for it, and, or even include that interface in a relevant interface group, and anything to make your config more readable. And of course, authpf was originally written to tame wireless networks, so. That's why this is the next slide in the presentation here. We have and then again, for any wireless networks, once you get past the they can be a real hassle to configure properly with the well, depending on whether you. For example, the well, WPA can be a real bitch to configure properly, and you will find out fairly quickly whether your operating systems developers have paid attention to all the needs of your device. Sometimes, well, there have been shouting matches over those. And do we? Have anybody working specifically on concentrating on Wi-Fi these days? Damien left, so.
There isn't really anybody.
So that's kind of a sore point, really, because well, I used to build OpenBSD access points for people, and yeah, we were happy with them. And they were, I could administer them remotely, and everybody was happy. But then, crap happens. And we're still taking. I think we've got some like 20. Yeah, something like half an hour to go. Any requests, any questions, any? I could go to the, well, if there are no requests, we could break early for lunch if you want, or I could do our please, any questions, you have the notes already, so you know roughly what a menu is, or we can improvise something. We haven't really covered logging. That's probably one of the required things. PF logs in binary, basically by copying packets and exporting them to the PF log interface. In modern operating systems, it's possible to have several PF log interfaces, so you can do something like we do in this slide here. I really need to do something about those font sizes. I'm sorry. anyway, what you do is you can log both passed and blocked, or for that matter, matched packets. But most of my examples here have a passed log. You can have matched log, and in this case, we also specify that we log to a specific PF log interface. Typically, you would do, and the way to read whatever PF logs to the log interface, you do you read it into clear text via TCP dump, something like this command line here, which gives you reasonable resolution on your times, and it's what. It also gives you the crucial information which rule was matched. For debugging your rule set, you really, you can do straight TCP dump on your interface and see whatever passes there. But if you want to debug a rule set, whatever passed here, the second line here matched rule 27, which will which you will find out what it is by PF control BSR. So you want this information for debugging purposes. Of course, if you you can TCP dump is your friend really. If you haven't read the man page, if you're at all involved in network administration, and I assume you people are since you're here. If you haven't spent some time with TCP dump already, please do read the man page. It's actually quite usable. I've been trying to talk Michael Lucas into writing a TCP dump mastery book. I have been thinking of that as the other option, but that's a lot more work. and I don't get to heckle Michael for it. So TCP dump mastery might be a project once I've recovered from the present point. Another possible book I wanted to write was Sane Email with OpenBSD, which is halfway written anyway. Now what you get is as we mentioned earlier, if you once you read off the PF log interface, you will get useful information like which rule actually matched, and you really really want that information if you're something is happening but you don't know why that is. Yeah, I would have something like this. Now, this one, I think it's actually identical to what's in the book, where you set up something like this, match log matches. We mentioned this earlier. You would, in practice, you would probably be a lot more specific where if you would match on, say, traffic from a specific host, like your laptop you're testing with. And what this does is, well, it matches inward match on the int IF. That's probably this rule. It says, okay, we match our match rule. But it also matches something that blocks for whatever, but is passed anyway because it matches a different pass rule. And finally, the packet will eventually pass out on the external interface. Yes. Yes. So it's okay, yeah. I need to revise this slide then to actually have it. TCP dump mastery or TCP dump is your friend might be written. Yes. So, but anyway, this is functionality that's only in recent OpenBSDs. Match matches was added a couple of releases back. I thought it was more recent, but no. Okay, so it came in.
Exactly there.
So, but anyway, for debugging purposes, this is pure gold. So, and as you correctly observed, the source address changes as it will in networks with NAT. So, and without the... all right. Yeah, so, yes.
I just realized that we're in the source.
Time, which means, it's actually been 7 or 8 releases then, but time flies when you're having fun. So basically, the match log matches is a really powerful tool in your tool set. Sorry, FreeBSD doesn't have it yet, but we need to heckle somebody on this conference to actually get that ported properly. Another thing, a common request is, well, how do we pipe this to syslog? Can we? Yes, we can. Something like, either you just say pflog to devnull, or you just kill pflogd. I'm not sure which is the more useful one. Anyway, what you could do is, you set up your syslog conf to actually receive something, and in this example, send it somewhere else. And all the magic is here, where you nohop a TCP dump that actually reads the pflog interface, feeds it to logger, and tags it with pf tag. Now, as you can probably imagine, this might generate a lot of data. So I'm not recommending you do this, but if you need to do it, this is the way to do it.
Decrease performance of PF, or is that a separate?
It will generate a lot of traffic. It will generate a lot of data that will go to your local hard disk or over the network to your log host. So depending on how, it might be enough to impact performance if your network is busy enough. If you only want to know what your network is doing, if metadata is okay, pflow.
Six months, they want to have access to this data. Mm.
Yeah, well, this one, but then again, really only want the metadata, you do not actually want the payload, pflow, not flow.
Yes, they only need the connection by filtering.
Yeah. So yeah.
The beginning.
Yeah. And with something like this, like every connection would generate megabytes of data, well, whatever, really whatever you, how much you log, with pflow, it's on the order of, I think, about 200 bytes per connection. I could be wrong, but it's not a lot more anyway. So so it will definitely take you further. And I think we already covered, yeah, labels. You want to cover, and of course, well, if you, well, you could well, for your purposes, you would be needing pflow for bandwidth billing. You would possibly use something like this for the label. Or you could probably also, well, you could usefully read that off pflow as well. So, and yes, there are a number of strange ways to generate your label names, but anyway, the labels are generated at start, at rules at load. So, all these, some of these variables are a little less interesting than they actually seem. And yes, here we have again sysnet states that we looked at in the that's another one. And of course, if you really want to look at, well, again, nice graphs for your bosses, pfstat still works. It was broken briefly after the new queue. But it now works again, and yeah, you can tell this is an old slide by the date here, but it's basically install a package. The example config file is actually quite usable, and you just muck around with it and see, pick your colors, and yeah, it works. We have. Well, logging is definitely something you should be looking into, and I might actually come back with TCP dump as your friend. That's, yeah. I haven't. Yes. Yep. Yes. A lot of things have happened recently. Do we have any? Well, back to the propaganda then. You want to transition from alt queue to priorities and queues, and yes, this is basically it. Anyone else wants coffee? If that's it, we're going to one last request from this side is. If you enjoyed this session, the best way to support OpenBSD is to send them money. You can get some items back, such as CD sets, T-shirts. The distribution is changing. So the old site may or may not be sold out. There will be a new one.
You're looking at me as if I was involved in that kind of thing.
Yeah, well, anyway, Alston is retiring.
Yes.
And his service for 20 years?
20 years.
Yeah, something like that. So Alston is a great guy, but he's finally saved up enough to buy himself a farm to retire to somewhere in Alberta. And yeah, we wish him well. So, but anyway, please buy OpenBSD stuff or just send him a donation. Grab your boss's credit card and send and have them buy.
For donations, you can find any of the OpenBSD developers here and just hand them something. It's easier for you.
Yes. But then again, if you want.
Well,
but then again, if your boss wants to have the proper paper mill, you can do well. At least for North American organizations, with the OpenBSD Foundation, as a Canadian nonprofit, that will accept donations and will supply the paperwork required. I am not quite sure how that works for European corporations. Well, anyway, you will if you ask them, they will give you the lots of paperwork and to make the tax man happy or so forth. It's also possible. Well, anyway, the best way to make sure PF and OpenBSD stays available and stays good is to send money to the OpenBSD project. If you want to support me, on the other hand, the best way is to buy the book. And you already, not the second edition, the third edition. Anyway, but there's, and if you're quick, if you're really quick, go to the BSD Sofia, 40% off will be, it will live at least for this conference and probably a few days more, but not a lot longer. And it's been live for 2 weeks already, and I haven't checked if anybody has figured out how to use it yet, but you can. Now, well, this is our secret. I will be showing it in my session tomorrow as well. And anybody who wants to buy the book for 40% off, welcome. I had hoped for having physical copies available here. Unfortunately, they're still being printed somewhere in North America. I heard was, they would probably be shipping them just after conference. But anyway, if you catch up with me at some later point with a book I've written, I will sign it for you. So, right. And I think we're possibly a little early for lunch, but we'll have coffee, I guess. So, no, I'm still here for questions, but if we're okay, we're... Yeah, right. Anyway, thanks for showing up.